And if you're here, you can come up and tell me, no, Dr. B, after class, and that'll be good. Now, we're going to be talking more about comets and asteroids today than asteroids, but all of it comes under the subtitle of planetary defense. Now, we talked mostly about asteroids last time. I want to talk about the comet and the dishwasher, and we're going to talk about the Stardust mission a little bit, and a meteorite called NWA-7034. And hopefully we'll have some homework between now and Thursday, and definitely over the spring break. So let's talk about the comet and the dishwasher. A while back, there was a mission called Deep Impact, and it launched sometime before 2005. And its mission, here's a picture of it, the spacecraft with a little subunit. Oh, let me get my cursor over here. Little subunit over here. The mission of Deep Impact was, it wasn't like the movie Deep Impact, which was pretty good, I thought. Well, there was some hokey stuff in it, but it was a lot better than Armageddon. That was really bad. I mean, scientifically bad. Deep Impact was a little bit better. Contact was better than that. Apollo 13 was better than Contact. Anyways, so Deep Impact, the mission was to fly by a comet that is in the near part of the solar system. You know, so in other words, not fly out to the Oort cloud way out there, but there's some of the comets, that are, just rumbling around in the inner part of the solar system, and observe it, and then blaze an impactor into the comet. So it had the normal power, communication, navigation, equipment on it. You can see it here, the spacecraft. It had two really nifty spectrometers, and the high resolution instrument, HRI, and the medium resolution instrument. And they had those two, and they were really nice spectrometers. And guess what they were looking for? Spectra. Spectrometers look for spectra. And they're looking for those quantum fingerprints, not just of hydrogen, oxygen, carbon, but even molecules, because they had infrared capability. And they had cameras, as all, they put camera on everything that flies out of our space program. And then they had something called the impactor. Okay, now that's this little subunit down here, all right? Let me get my cursor up here. Come on, cursor. There we go. Okay, so this subunit here is the impactor, and it carries some instruments of its own, cameras and so forth. All right, now on July 4th, 2005, the impactor, which in newspaper accounts you'll see it described as about the size of a dishwasher, but it's not shaped like a dishwasher, but you put that and a dishwasher side by side, they'll fit in the same size box, approximately, I guess. I've never seen it in real life. And it crashed into the nucleus of comet Tempel 1. And that's the comet. Now, they were approaching it for several days. So the main spacecraft, and although you can see the MRI and the HRI on there, okay, the two spectrometers, and they were looking at the coma, the surrounding cloud of material for days, and then about 24 hours before impact, they released the Kraken, in other words, the impactor, okay, and they crashed it in there, and at the same time, the main spacecraft fired its retro rockets and slowed down a little bit so that it would stay back, all right? and it kept standoff distance so that it could observe the impact from a good distance and record all the smithereens. Now let's take a look at the spacecraft. So that's the basic outline of the mission up there. And let's take a look at some more of the equipment. Okay, so the main spacecraft is over here on the left, all right, over here. And you can see how, you know, it's got the two spectrometers that are aimed in the same direction. And it's got over here star trackers. These are telescopes up here connected to a bunch of computers. And, you know, they keep track of where it is in space in three dimensions. And they actually look at stars. And ever since the 60s, NASA has been navigating by the stars. They have very, very precise measurements, and their computer programs track it. And so you can keep an eye on where you are with respect to the stars, and therefore you know exactly where you are with respect to Earth, etc. And so here's the impactor over here. And it's got a big rocket engine here, and it's got a bunch of smaller ones as well. They're not easy to see in this picture. Up here is the back end of it, and I believe this is the impact end of it. It's, in other words, it's supposed to go in from that direction. Now, here are the main instruments, another look at them. And as you already saw, the two spectrometers are here and here. This one that looks like a cylinder, that's the high resolution. This one that's a, kind of a box, a rectangular box, that's medium resolution. So they're catching spectra every, you know, second or every minute or whatever the time setting is. And, you know, that's the valuable data. And they got cameras and stuff. But then this third instrument here, this is the gun sight. We're putting Comet Temple 1 into our gun sight. We're trying to shoot it down. Now, we ain't going to shoot it down with a dishwasher. It's a pretty big, monstrous piece of, or it's actually more like a snowdrift, supposedly. It's pretty loose. And for those of you that are from Florida, snow is this white crystalline stuff that forms from water at certain temperatures, and it falls out of the sky. It's kind of nice. And anyways, so here's the impactor targeting sensor. It's the gun sight. And that's mounted. You can't see it in the picture of the impactor. It's kind of mounted from top to bottom, and it's inside, so you can't really see it from this view. But that's how the impactor sights in on the comet. Now it was a pretty nice shot. They got it, July 4th, 2005. Let's have a look. And I got a movie here, so we'll try to play this a couple times. See how this goes. I think this will work. Let me get my cursor back. Come on, baby. Wait a minute.
Thank you.
And now it's off on its way. Let's look at that again. So yes, now let's go through some of the specs for this impact. And this is from from University of Maryland. I'll give you the web address. You can read it up in a later on. All right, so about 24 hours before impact, the impactor separates. We saw that in the movie. Now, the impactor delivers 29 gigajoules of kinetic energy. That's equivalent to 4.8 tons of TNT. Now, a few tons of TNT would be like a pile as big as this chalk, this moving whiteboard from there out to, you know, maybe out to the middle of the room. So in other words, it's big compared to us. But compared to this comet. But it's still, you can see that impact. That's a real image of the impact. All right. And you can see some of the sub images there. And just type in deep impact and temple one, T-E-M-P-E-L one. And you'll see Buku images, all kinds of images. I mean, they got this thing. They got it wrapped. All right. So kinetic energy, in case you're a little rusty on your physics, your basic physics, it's the energy of motion, and it's from the mass and the velocity. And the velocity is about 10.2 kilometers per second, so it's really whipping. And the formula for kinetic energy is this. We're not going to calculate it, but, you know, this is for the historical record. You can jot this down. Kinetic energy is 1/2 mv squared. And it's good, you know, you just multiply 370 kilograms times the square of 10.2 kilometers per second, and you get a bunch of joules of energy. A joule is the metric unit of energy. Kilowatt hour is electrical company. Duke Energy, unit of energy. What's the English? Horsepower is a power. Horsepower second would be a unit of energy, and calorie is a unit of energy. And we usually associate that with food. You know, you get energy from food and stuff.
A food calorie is 1,000.
Right. A food calorie, that's right, there's two kinds of calories. The thermal calorie based on the temperature of liquid water, and then the food calorie, which is also known in the chemistry department as a kcal or kilocalorie. Let's see, but I can't think what the English, in physics, we don't really use the English system hardly at all, except for inches and yards and miles, but I can't even think of what the English unit of energy is. Anyways, in metric system, it's joules. Now, for comparison, They have it written down here that the velocity when it impacts about 10.2 kilometers per second. And you may be saying to yourself, dude, that's nothing. 10.2 kilometers? That's the distance from here out to Semarin Boulevard, maybe, or maybe a little further. But do that in 1 second? Yeah, that's pretty good. Our best airplane at Mr. SR-71, Blackbird, best speed supposedly is about 1 kilometer per second. So that dishwasher is going to about 10 times that. So that's a pretty nice speed. The moon, and by the way, the moon on its orbit also goes about the speed of the SR-71 at maximum public speed. I mean, probably the top end of SR-71's a little bit higher than that, but. And that's the planes that we know of. You know, all the other things they got cooking out there at Area 51, who knows? Anyway, so now here's some more. This is item 4. The targeting and hitting the comet in a lit area, they wanted it to be on the sunny side, right, so they could see everything. And, you know, just getting sunlight reflected off smithereens and reflected off the surface, just analyzing the sunlight that comes back and the sunlight that gets absorbed, you see absorption features, you can spot pyroxenes, carbonate minerals, whatever whatever the absorption features tell you. So they wanted it in a lit area, and it's going to be going pretty fast. And they want to target, you know, they figured out we'll try to get this into a 6 kilometer square. Or a 6 kilometer circle, I guess, from a distance of about 864,000 kilometers. All right, so that's twice as far as the moon. All right, now, we can put things onto the moon fairly well, but it ain't easy. And same thing here. Plus, you're doing it at high speed. All right, so it's just like right now they're trying to develop these ballistic missile defenses from the Aegis system at sea, and you know, the ground-based interceptors. Basically there you're trying to hit an incoming ballistic missile with another missile, or as they say in the business, hit a bullet with a bullet. And it's similar here, although they have a bigger target, so that makes it a little bit easier. But it's still, anyway, so they use a high precision star tracker called the impactor target sensor, ITS. That's what we were looking at. Developed by the JPL, Jet Propulsion Laboratory, to guide it to the target. And you know, we have the picture up there on upper right, emphasized. But let me point something out in there. Did you see that in item 6, auto navigation algorithms? See that? Go ahead and underline that or make a note. Just jot down that sentence. Now, this is 2005, 13 years ago. All right? Big, high-tech, 13 years ago. Now, we're putting it into cars. And I'm guessing, now, it's a completely different navigation task. You know, trying to hit the broadside of a comet nucleus versus, I don't know how anybody would trust a car to do this, but navigating through the freeway system of Los Angeles or anywhere else. But that's what we're doing now. And my guess is that a bunch of guys that worked on this project for JPL are now working for these, pilotless or driverless vehicle companies doing their auto navigation algorithms. I still wouldn't trust them. They did a pretty nice job with Deep Impact, but. So then you got minor trajectory corrections and attitude control using the small hydrazine propulsion. Hydrazine is a really powerful but really, really bad compound that they use in the space. I don't know where else they use it, but they use it on spacecraft to fire retro rockets and stuff. The lunar excursion module used it to land. It's really powerful, but it's really dangerous. Okay, and so you would never have a car powered by hydrazine because it's extremely toxic as well. The exhaust is bad stuff. Anyway, so they have hydrazine retro rockets stuff, you know, to get it into the right position and so forth. And my final comment to you is simply this. The movie makes it look easy, but baby, I'm sure it was not. It was a nice shot. Davy Crockett, baby. They got it. All right? They hit the target. And here's another image. Notice anything about... Go to all off. Look at this image carefully. You see anything about it? What's that? What do you see? Look at it carefully. This is a false... This is an image of the nucleus plus a little bit extra info overlay. Go ahead to 50%, please. What do you see? Anything? What's that? Geysers? No. But you're actually warm. What do you see? Yeah, this blue stuff. They made it bluer, they false color blued it. That's H2O, water. And here's some more down here. So yeah, you know, we think that the water on the surface of the Earth, most of it came in from comets. Also another, wait a minute now, Jenny's over here shaking her head.
We're not thinking that anymore.
Oh. You know, that means Umberto Campins was wrong. Ooh, blazed. He's still advertising that too as his big. Yeah, it's up on the web. Anyway, so where did the water come from? No. So it used to be that everybody thought that water came in from comets. And comets do have, you know, comets, if they impact Earth, they will have a lot of water. But you know, the thing is, there's a lot of water. You know, where did the comets get it? From the solar nebula, and you know, there's all kinds of ices and stuff, so it's likely that the Earth acquired it. You know, if it's not, you know, Jenny's my sensor over here. She puts a check on me when I'm blazing up my mouth, shooting off my big mouth. But you know, the thing is, we're always interested in water. On Mars, on Mercury, on the Moon, anywhere we could, in other planets, exoplanets.
Specify liquid water or ice water, because there's a lot of water in pretty much every rock as like a hydrated mineral.
That's
so
right.
Water isn't special, but liquid water is.
Yeah.
Special.
So that's correct. So even rocks have water, and in them, hydrated minerals. But we always like seeing it. Now, here's another interesting fact about the Deep Impact's, the main spacecraft. After it detonated its dishwasher into the sunny side of the Temple 1 nucleus, it went to visit this particular comet, which is also out in the same general vicinity. So they did a little flyby of Comet Hartley 2, got a bunch of pictures. And look at this now. You can see that on the sunny side, this thing's blazing out a lot of stuff. It's geysering out, or as they say in the planetary science business, it's outgassing a lot of stuff. And it's reflected sunlight. You can see it. It looks a little bit like those geysers at the bottom of Enceladus, but this is actually a comet nucleus, Hartley 2. So we've had a bunch of comets that we've looked at closely. We want to keep doing it as much as we can. Next, I want to talk about the Stardust mission, and with that, isotopic ratios, which is crucial for understanding the Stardust mission and what the Stardust mission learned. Now, this is another comet mission to a different comet. And but if you recall from a lecture on February 1st, remember this? We talked about isotopes. Just kind of the intro to isotopes. We're going to go deeper into it today. You know, for instance, the atomic number 26 for iron, Fe, basically tells you how many protons in the nucleus and how many electrons in a neutral, unionized atom of hydrogen. All right, so 26 protons, 26 electrons. And then the upper number is the isotope number or the mass number. And that tells you how many nucleons in the nucleus. So a nucleon is the generic term, the generic noun, for objects in the nucleus, i.e. either neutron or proton. All right. So it's like the word ingredients. You know, you look in on the nutrition information on a box of cereal, and it'll tell you the ingredients. You know, sugar. That's usually the first ingredient. And then a little bit of high fructose corn syrup, another form of sugar. And then refined cane syrup, another form. And then they get to, you know, whatever it's made out of, corn, wheat, oatmeal, or something like that. All right, so those things are like specific ingredients. But the word ingredients is you could say, well, how many ingredients are there? Well, there's seven. But some of it might be sugar, some of it might be corn, wheat, or something like that. And that's what the word nucleon is like. It's like the ingredient number. It tells you the number of ingredients in a nucleus. So some of the forms of iron that we see in the universe, on our planet, iron 26 comes in these flavors, 54, 56, 57, and 58. All right. So iron 54 has about 28 neutrons in it. Iron 56 has 30. Iron 57 has 31. Because 57 minus 26 is 31. Iron 58, and that's usually how we refer to it. We don't usually say iron 26, 58. We usually say just iron 58. I mean, if you're going to type it out in a text message, you'd type in the word iron, and then a dash, and then 58. Okay? And so that has 32 neutrons in the nucleus. All right? And then on Earth, they come in different abundances. And then in stars, they might come in a slightly different abundance. You know, like for us, Most iron is of the iron 56 variety. Now, chemically, and here's something to reinforce. The chemical reaction of any of these four iron molecules or iron isotopes is exactly the same as any of the other isotopes. So you could have, you know, like rust, iron oxide. Or fool's gold. Do you know what the chemical composition of fool's gold? It's got iron in it, I think. Iron pyrite. That's fool's gold. It's got iron in it, right? So roughly, 92% of your iron pyrite molecules, 92% of your iron oxide rust molecules are going to have an iron 56. But a few of them are going to have iron 54. And a few are going to have 57. And a very few are going to have iron 58. And what I'm going to teach you today is how we analyze the isotopes. And we're going to do some other stuff here. But get your clicker out. I want to do a quicker question with you, just to see if your brain is up to speed. And if your brain is not up to speed, we're going to get it up to speed. Okay, so hold on a second. Iron. FeS2. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So Fool's gold, iron pyrite. Pyrite, that's sulfur. Right? That's the iron pyrite. Fool's gold is FeS2. So, you know, you take 100 iron pyrite molecules from Earth, and on average, 92 of them are going to be iron 56. And you can tell that in the, you know, if you analyze them, you know, you can tell them apart. And I'm going to show you how to do that in a second. But first, let's do a clicker question. Here's number one, oxygen isotope. Hopefully this one's easy for you. There's a little slice of the periodic table about oxygen. Oxygen 17. How many protons in the nucleus? Good. This should be like approximately 100%. Fire. Yeah. So sulfur is related to that. Yeah. I didn't know that. That's cool. Okay, 20 seconds. That's interesting. Yeah. 10 seconds. 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Okay, yeah, 8 is the correct number. 73% of you got that. And for those of you that blooped it, it's always this number up here. Right here, the 8. All right, how many neutrons in the nucleus? Question number 2. For oxygen 17. Right, so hopefully this is a cinchy one. Neutrons, not protons, not nucleons. Okay, 20 seconds. Ten, nine, eight, seven, six, five, four, three, two, one, zero. Okay. 68% of you, that is not acceptable. The correct answer is 9. All right, if you did not get that one right, you better write it down. The isotope number 17 minus the number of protons. That's the way it works. The isotope number 17 tells, that's the ingredients of the nucleus. How many nucleons? 8 of them are protons, therefore the leftovers are neutrons. All right, so make sure you know. And that's going to be important to us. I'm going to tell you how we analyze isotopes. And we're going to go back to the famous Manhattan Project in World War II. And this is a picture, photograph, of the Y-12 facility up in Oak Ridge. Matter of fact, at the time, if you were a normal civilian in the United States, you would never be able to see this photograph. But now you can, you know, it's unclassified. And this is a big isotope separate, enormous building. If you look at carefully at that, you can see how big that is, and it's still under, and at the time of the photograph, it was being constructed, and several other facilities up there. And what it was used for was to separate the isotopes of uranium. So make a note of that. Uranium isotopes in nature, there's two main ones. Now, uranium is really rare. It's not a very abundant metal. We can mine, we know there's various places to mine it. Here in the U.S., in North America, there's some places apparently over in Africa where you can mine it. You know, various other places, probably somewhere over in Siberia. And New Jersey's got low-grade uranium ore, various places. That's just something my high school earth science teacher told me. He was all up. He wasn't in the Manhattan Project. He wasn't that old, but he knew a lot about it. And anyway, so this facility and a bunch of, so what they did was they separated, okay, here are the two main ones, uranium-235, so that's 235 nucleons. Oh, and by the way, the atomic number is 92. So it's uranium-235, 92. And then the other isotope is uranium-238, 92. All right. All uraniums are 92s, 92 protons in the nucleus, 92 electrons orbiting the nucleus in a neutral uranium atom. And then, let's see, so 235 minus 72, 28 plus 35 is what? 28 plus 35. 163, is that right? So there's 163 neutrons. 238 would be 92 minus 230. No, 238 minus 92 is what? 100. Wait a minute, that's not right. No, 235 minus 92 is 140. What is it, 143? Come on, somebody calculate that. Get your calculator. You should have your calculators out all the time, instantaneously. And obviously my subtraction skills are limping along today.
It's
235, so 143 neutrons in the uranium-230. And then three more than that, so 146. Yeah, 235 minus 92 is 146. All right, now this is what they were separating. And here's a kind of a schematic diagram of what they do. They have down here at the bottom an ion source. So they heat it up so that it vaporizes the atoms. And they go, put a little pinhole opening, and so those ions, you know, each one of them is going to be a different mass, and they've got a chlorine attached to it, okay? So it's a chemical compound at this point, all right? But the chlorines are all the same, and the uraniums are not, all right? So in a magnetic field, so they go out this pinhole, and then they go through a slit, which is kind of exaggerated here, just to make it into a beam. And then the beam separates. The 235s cut, if you look at this picture, you can sketch this. If you look at this picture, the 235 ions cut the corner a little bit sharper. Okay, so they land in this bin up here. All right. And then the 238, they're a little bit bulkier. So they don't respond to the magnetic field as quickly. So they kind of mosey along a little bit bigger of a trajectory. Right? So they do this out here. Now at that facility, Y12, that's what they were doing. They had this machine called the calutron. And that's how they did it. At least that's one of the methods that they had. So here's another picture. And this is from 1940s era documents here, this one. So that's kind of a sideways picture of what we just looked at. Today we can use a centrifuge, and that's like, you see in a biology lab. Anybody ever been in a biology lab where you used a centrifuge to separate, good. When they separate, your blood from your red cells from your plasma and stuff, they do it in a centrifuge. Who's had chemistry? Has anybody used a centrifuge in a chemistry lab? Yes? Use it in chemistry too? Yeah, okay. And it separates things out according to how heavy they are or how dense. Okay? So the denser... So one part of your test tube has got dense stuff, and another part of the test tube has less dense, Okay, so in that case, in the case of uranium, that'd be the less dense would be uranium-235, which is what they want, and then the uranium-235, which they separate out and use for something else. Another process is called gaseous diffusion, which they also did at Oak Ridge. And that's because gases will diffuse different, you know, two gases at the same temperature, but if each molecule of the gas is slightly, one kind of molecule slightly heavier, they'll diffuse different distances and at different speeds, average speeds, right? So that's one of the things they took advantage of. And then, of course, there's the electromagnetic separation, which is what we've got diagrammed here, the calutron, which was at Oak Ridge as well, at the Y-12 building and so forth. And there's other methods to separate them. But these are the big factory industrial strength methods. And so as a bit of public education from the news, right now the United States and a lot of the civilized part of the world, or a lot of the Western world, I should say, are opposed to Iran. And Iran is trying to develop nuclear weapons that they can use to destroy Israel and the United States. I mean, everybody that they have a grudge against. All right. And so right now in Iran, they're trying to refine. They've got uranium ore, and what they want to do is refine it. So you can't build an atomic weapon with the stuff that comes out of the mountainside. It may have uranium in it, but it's got to be refined. So they do all kind of, you know, they break up the rock, they pulverize it, you know, and then they separate it out chemically and, you know, do all kinds of things. And eventually they can put it into a centrifuge or gaseous diffusion or a calutron. And apparently what the Iranians are doing right now is building centrifuges. And they have to be really, really precise and very strong, very light, so they don't fly apart, and separate a little bit of uranium-235 from uranium-238. And then they put it into and the way that it works, they have a whole set of centrifuges. You know, so they bring it down, you know, to 1% uranium-235, and then the next centrifuge brings it down at 2%, and the next one brings it down to 4%, and the next one brings it down to 8%, et cetera, et cetera. And gradually they build it up. And, you know, so they're basically doing this, you know, things, you know, separate according to mass. Here's a close up. You know, so whether you use it in a centrifuge, it's, you know, different parts of the test tube or whatever the container is that they're spinning in the centrifuge. In a calutron, it's different parts of the machine. But what they're trying to do is refine it down to weapons-grade uranium. And so you may as well make a note here in your notes. I think I'll put it on the next test just as a general education project question. Weapons-grade and reactor-grade, power-grade, you know what they would put in a nuclear reactor, are two different concentrations. So if you know that people are concentrating uranium, I think it's about 5% is all you need. Very low percentage to power a nuclear reactor, okay? And a nuclear reactor is undergoing nuclear fission, but it's the concentration of uranium is low enough that they can control it. There's various ways to control the speed of the nuclear reaction. A weapons grade has got to be up to, I don't think anybody has 100%, but as high a percentage as they can. So if we see somebody that's refining 30-40%, that's way higher than they need for a reactor. So what that tells us is they're trying to develop a weapon, all right? And so that's what all these, you read in the news, the UN sends in inspectors and an outfit called the International Atomic Energy Agency, which I think is part of the UN, but I'm not sure, IAEA, and they send in inspectors, and they look around. You know what they do? They look at dust around these facilities, because a little bit of this stuff will get out into the in the environment, and they take air samples, you know, and a little bit of dust in the air, and what they do, and then they put it like in a calutron or something, and then they analyze it. And if they see that it's highly enriched in uranium, then they know, all right, these guys are trying to build a weapon. They may not be saying it, but that's what they're trying to do. All right, now, just in a few years ago, the U.S., the United States made a deal of some kind, who knows, with the Iranians to not enrich past the grade needed for a reactor program. You know, everybody, you know, nuclear reactors for power, a little electricity, it's nice, you know. It's good. We know how to do it, you know, really good. Except for the Russians. They had that big disaster over in Chernobyl back in the 80s, you know, 30 years ago. You guys weren't even born, most of you. It's a horrible disaster in Chernobyl because they were screwing around with their nuclear reactors over there. Did you realize that? Some idiot was doing an experiment in Chernobyl with a nuclear reactor, and the whole thing blew, and, you know, the whole, you know, square miles of the Ukraine are poisoned forever, you know, for thousands of years because of these idiots over there running that reactor. Anyways, the reaction got away from them and they couldn't control it and it blew the reactor. It didn't cause a real explosion. It caused what we call a meltdown. The China syndrome is what they call that. Anyway, so you use the 235 for reactors and weapons. Yeah. So you use it at a low concentration for reactors, high concentration for weapons. And so we like to know who's doing that because hopefully, you know, there's all kinds of movies about maniacs, you know, like Dr. Evil. Well, Dr. Evil's not a maniac. He's a would-be maniac. But I mean, in you know, all kinds of movies, you know, you watch TV over the weekend, you know, like Wesley Snipes is a top secret agent. He has to parachute into the Soviet Union because some Chechen rebels have taken over a nuclear plant and they're going to detonate a nuclear weapon and all stuff. So our philosophy is, okay, the Russians, we used to be really afraid of the Russians. And they had nuclear weapons. And like back in the 50s and 60s, when they started testing their weapons and we could see it, you know, we basically, the way that we saw it was we floated things in the atmosphere. They collected atmospheric samples over Siberia and then analyzed them when, you know, brought them back to Earth and analyzed them. Or we flew airplanes around the borders of Siberia, and we still do this today in North Korea. Fly an aircraft around the border or along the border and catch whiffs of air and analyze it for isotopes, not of uranium, but other radioactive isotopes that betray the presence of a nuclear detonation. Because under certain isotopes in the periodic table of elements are only manufactured in a nuclear detonation. They won't be manufactured in a chemistry lab, only in a nuclear detonation. Now, 60 years ago, what is this, 2018? So 60 years ago, in 1958, in the era of Sputnik, you know, we were deathly afraid of the Russians that they had atomic weapons. And that Sputnik, I was reading about it, it's all in this book called Hidden Figures. Sputnik, you know, nobody knew that Sputnik was going to be launched. And so Sputnik comes blazing over Kansas and Iowa and West Virginia. And, you know, and everybody can see it. If the sun angle's right, you can see it going across the sky. And the military could track it, you know, because it was sending out beeps. So they knew it was going overhead. And everybody was worried. All right, well, it's just a little, it's a little metal sphere with a beeper in it. Nice. But what if that was a nuclear weapon? And that's the real fear. Because the Sputnik showed that the Russians had missiles. We knew they had weapons that they could deliver in an airplane, a big bomber. But it showed that they had missiles that could deliver a nuclear weapon. So that's... But now, back in the 70s and 80s, they made a bunch of treaties, arms limitation treaties with the Russians, because the Americans and the Russians came to realize that they're both not madmen, right? So in other words, some evil genius, we figured that the Russians, as much as the Soviets, the Soviet Union, as much as we fear communism and hate it, and they're not maniacs, they're rational people. And so that's the basis of our trust. You know, we still have satellites to scope out everything that they do. But we made these treaties and stuff with the Russians, and the French and the English and the Chinese made treaties, various treaties. Let's see, who else? French, English, Chinese. Now, the Israelis supposedly have nuclear weapons. I don't believe they've ever admitted it. And they've never signed any treaties about it. And they've also never used it. But the fear is that, you know, if a certain kind, like Syria had a nuclear reactor that the Israelis blew up a few years ago, that they figured out was trying to make weapons grade, I think it was trying to make plutonium, which is the other element that you can use for an atomic weapon or for a reactor. And so so the Israelis went in and nuked it, or they didn't nuke it, they bombed it and destroyed it. So the fear is that if a maniac gets a hold, if we see a maniac with centrifuges going past 10% enrichment, we start to get nervous. And so that's what this is about. Anyways, we have a little bit happier topic to talk about with isotopes. I think we're going to get this thing squared away in Korea and Iran as well, because most of the people in Iran, people are people. I mean, that's what it gets down to. I mean, there may be a few screws loose up at the top, and you could say that about any country in the world, I suppose, if you don't like them. But you know, in Iran, people are people, you know, it's just like these guys, and just, you know, and in Korea as well. North Korea's got it pretty bad, though. They're in rough conditions over there. Anyways, I want to talk about this. SMOW. 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 It is an acronym. SMOW. And it is all about isotopes. So let's keep going with isotopes. We know this, so there's some stable ones. And here's a little bit of enrichment. Some decay radioactively to daughter nuclei. So uranium nucleus will spontaneously decay into smaller nuclei. Okay, that's why it's easy to split if you want to deliberately do it, but it also spontaneously split. So some of them split and decay in minutes or days. That's considered fairly rapid. Example of that is radium, one of the first radioactive elements discovered by Madame Curie over 100 years ago. Some of them take about 1,000 years on average. An example of that is carbon. The unstable nuclei of carbon are manufactured in the atmosphere, breathed in by humans and animals, photosynthesis up by plants, and then when the plant is chopped down or eaten, when the animal dies or is eaten, It no longer replenishes the radioactive isotope, and so it starts to decay, and we can tell from that it no longer replenishes its carbon isotope that decays. So the carbon keeps decaying, but it doesn't get replenished. So now we can measure the ratio of carbon isotopes to other isotopes and figure out the age. And that's basically what we do with carbon dating. Now that's good for a few thousand years. I think they go up to maybe 40,000 years or so with carbon dating before it becomes, we can't measure precisely enough to go much past there. And some of the isotopes are really, really long, billions of years. So uranium to lead, uranium decays to lead through a kind of a chain of daughter nuclei. And that process takes billions of years. Now, the thing about it is, carbon dating, radioactive carbon isotopes, are used for dating archaeological things. So 40,000 years is pretty good for archaeology. You know, you can get, you know, all your Cro-Magnon man and woolly mammoths from Siberia and, you know, the Neanderthals from Germany and, you know, all the Native American peoples in North America. And we find whether, basically what we do is we find a campsite, we look at the fireplace, get some of the carbon, which was produced by burning wood, and then we can even date. It's incredible. There's a layer of carbon that is a few thousand years old. It's called the black layer, and it's only visible in certain parts of North America. It's a rock layer with a lot of carbon in it, black carbon, and they think it's from fires from a comet or asteroid that impacted in Canada and caused fires all over North America. It leading to smoke, and then when the smoke settled, you know, a lot of carbon from those fires. That's what some people think. So and that's carbon dating. So they know exactly, I think it's like 12,000, 14,000 years, something like that, you know, during the Ice Age. And so we can date things archaeologically with carbon. Geologically, uranium is pretty good, and I'm pretty sure they used uranium dating on moon rocks. There are other isotopes, not just these. I mean, there's a rubidium, RU, isotope that they use for dating. It's not billions of years, it's more on the order of millions of years that it's good for. So basically, age and location can be deduced, but you gotta start checking down at the level of parts per million for each isotope. So for like iron, it's at the level of percentages, but most of the time, your other isotopes, you gotta be more precise than percentage. You have to go down to parts per million, right? And sometimes you compare the ratios of like oxygen 17 and oxygen 18. And you know, you construct a ratio that's also indicative. And that is where SMOW comes in, all right? In the isotope ratios in the oceans of Earth. So here they are. SMOW, standard mean ocean water, all right? So, and we use it for hydrogen ratios, hydrogen and deuterium isotope ratios, and then we also use it for oxygen because water is H2O. So we use, you know, take a zillion samples of ocean water, analyze them in a machine like a calutron or maybe a centrifuge, and then count how many deuteriums, how many regular hydrogens, how many oxygen 16s, how many oxygen 18s, how many oxygen 17s. And then you average it over the entire ocean, you know, and over many years, and you come up with this. Oxygen 18 over oxygen 16 abundance is about 2005.20 parts per million. All right. So that, you know, and that's 2 parts per 1,000, 2.00520 parts per 1,000. But usually these are expressed in per million. But you can write it as a percentage. 0.200, so about 0.2%. You know. So that's not bad. That's a fairly good fraction of heavy oxygen. And then oxygen 17, SMOW for oxygen 17 compared to oxygen. You know, most oxygen is oxygen 16. You know, that's, you know, 99.9% or something like that. And oxygen 17 to oxygen 16, so this is the intermediate one, is 379.9 parts per million. And, or you could write it down as a percentage, 0.03799%. Now, my wonderful students, we're going to be doing calculations with these. And I'm going to be showing you how to do calculations with oxygen isotope ratios probably on Thursday. All right? And the reason that they're important is these are the standards by which we rate other objects that we find. But for oxygen and hydrogen. Now, there's another standard for carbon. And believe it or not, the carbon standard is not ocean water, because there's not much carbon in ocean water. But there's a lot of carbon in limestone, calcium carbonate, CaCO3. So the carbon in, there's a geological formation up in South Carolina by the PD River, and that formation has been well studied. It's very uniform, and that provides the carbon standard. But for oxygen and hydrogen,
yep,
SMOW. So when we look at meteorites, when we look at comet spectra, yeah, we're always trying to figure out and compare to SMOW. All right, and so some meteorites, and this graph over here, if you look at the vertical scale, that's the delta oxygen 17 ratio over here. I'll be showing you how to compute that on Thursday. And down here, that's the oxygen 18, delta oxygen 18 ratio. And when you plot, you know, you measure those isotopes for a meteorite, and then you plot both of them on this scale on a piece of graph paper, all the rocks of the moon form a line. You know, they don't always have the same fraction, but they form a line. Meteorites tend to be on a different line. And this group down here, the CAIs, those are calcium. They're loaded with calcium. They're meteorites loaded with calcium. And they have a decidedly different set of oxygen isotope ratios. Now, some of the chondrules up here, see, these are meteorites up here. Those are chondrules, or as they say in the business, chondrules. And those are a certain kind of meteorite as well. We look at chondrules inside of meteorites, and some of them are pretty close to the Earth-Moon line. That's cool. Some of them are dipped down a little bit more, but these CAIs that we see in meteorites, very interesting, way off the chart. But they form a pattern, they form a line. It's just different from the Earth-Moon line. All right. Now here's NWA-7034. It was found in Northwest Africa. NWA stands for Northwest Africa. It was found in 2011. And you can see that they've taken a diamond saw and sliced off a bit of it. And here's some references, and I just want you to look at this. The petrography, this is somebody named C.A.G. from University of New Mexico. Look at these big words. Porphyritic basaltic monomixed breccia with a few euhedral phenocrysts up to several millimeters and many phenocryst fragments of dominant andesine, low Ca pyroxene, pigeonite, and augite set in a very fine-grained clastic to plumose ground mass. X-ray diffraction. They zap it with X-rays and see what comes back out. Feldspar. That's a big mineral in granite. Low calcium pyroxene. clinopyroxenes, iron oxides, alkali feldspars, and apatite. A-P-A-T-I-T-E. Did you know that that's the mineral in your bones? Pigeonite. Where's pigeonite from? It's from Pigeon Point. We see it in this NWA meteorite, but it's the pigeonite that we find in that meteorite is very similar to the pigeonite on Pigeon Point. And where is Pigeon Point? It's in the middle of Lake Superior. Pigeon Point, have you ever been there? Pigeon Point, Minnesota. You go canoeing up there. There's a lot to learn. We'll talk about NWA 7034 and other stuff on Thursday. You're dismissed. Almost to the end.